Namo Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Shrimati Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namine Namaste Saraswati Devi Golamani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatta Vishutani.
Hare Krishna, everybody. This is the second year that we've had class out in the courtyard with a few different senior speakers. And one of the reasons for that is there's a growing sense that what we see behind us is going to be, it's history in the making. And oftentimes when history is being made, the people present for that, that event, it's not necessarily that it's perceived even by them and certainly not by the wider public. But there's a growing sense right now, and we also are thinking that the very fact that the TOVP building will take another, it's been going for 3 years, I think, and it will take another, where are we, 15, it will take about another 7 years. So as time passes, and it's taking that time, I think that will become more apparent. So I think this will be an annual event, at least until we can have our Bhagavatam class actually in the new temple. That new temple, just for your information, will comfortably sit 5,000 people. Standing about 10,000, sitting about 5,000 comfortably. So I don't think there's 5,000 people here today, so we'll need to bring a few more people to Mayapur when we have our Bhagavatam classes there. So just before we have our first speaker speak, I'll just say that to thank Bhaktichuru Maharaj and thank Gopal Krishna. Well, Bhaktichuru Maharaj for being on time, for Gopal Krishna Maharaj just being a little bit late, and we won't thank our other speakers who are decidedly late. They would be, as we say, they would be late for their own funeral. Yesterday we were having a discussion here in Mayapur at one of the GBC meetings. We're having a discussion about sorting out where all the samadhis would be, as we know, and all glories, by the way, to Ganagamya, who left his body a few days ago. And we are thinking of his wife and family at this time. And also another wonderful devotee passed away a few days before that. So there will be a need, samadhis, and also a memorial wall, where we will put a memorial wall that we can put plaques of the different devotees that are leaving. But because we're still working on those details, we decided we would pass a resolution. And the resolution, I should inform you, is that the GBCs of Mayapur have said that nobody can leave their body. There's a moratorium on anybody leaving their body until we sort out where these things go.
It's a joke.
Okay, so the theme of today's class is the Ekakya Marna Nahi Paya Bolo verse, Harinam Sankirtane. The Lord Chaitanya himself said that I alone cannot continue the Sankirtan movement of the chanting of the holy names of Hari. I need all of your help. So this was Lord Chaitanya himself saying that he needed help to continue the Sankirtan movement. So that is also the message from all of the devotees involved with the TOVP building behind you, that they alone cannot fulfill this project or complete this project, and they need all of your help. So today's class will be focusing on those on the TOVP and different aspects of it, and I'd now like to invite His Holiness Bhaktichuru Maharaj to say a few words. Thank you, Maharaj.
Hare Krishna. So, how many of you have come from outside to Mayapur? Wonderful. And how many of you are really impressed with Mayapur? And how many of you want this temple of Vedic Planetarium to come up? Wonderful. So the temple of Vedic Planetarium, generally we know about temples, Radha Krishna temple, Radha Shamsundar temple, Radha Madan Mohan temple. But isn't that quite a strange name? Temple of Vedic Planetarium. T-O-V-P. Temple of Vedic Planetarium. Why did Srila Prabhupada select a name like that? The reason is Srila Prabhupada wanted to defeat, not just defeat, but expose the bluff of modern science. In Back to Godhead, quite some years ago, an article came up called The Scientist's Bluff. What the scientists most of the time are saying is total bluff. They're simply lying. When Srila Prabhupada got the news of the moon landing, actually at that time Srila Prabhupada was having a massage, and the TV was, I think Prabhupada was somewhere in England, or like the TV was at the back, and the devotees were watching the moon landing, and Prabhupada was having an oil massage. Maybe Harisori Prabhu was giving him the massage. Not at that time. And they were also excited about the moon landing. And you know what was Prabhupada's response? No, they never went to moon. They never went to moon. Because Srila Prabhupada knew that one cannot go to moon in this way. It's another planet. One has to have another kind of body to go there. Just by adjusting with some sort of arrangement, one cannot go to moon. One has to be qualified to enter into that planet. Just like in order to go to sun, can you imagine sun? Sun is a fiery planet. Can anybody just go there? He'll immediately burn to ashes. Moon planet is a cold place, extremely cold. We can't even imagine what is the temperature of moon. And besides that, moon planet, according to the Vedic understanding, it's so far away. And you know something? About 12 years back, in 2003, a Gallup poll was taken in America, and 33% of the people expressed their disbelief in moon landing. When they kind of started to publicize that the moon, they landed in moon, there was so much excitement that people are even buying land in moon. They thought they'll go there and a new colony will be established in moon and so forth. And Prabhupada later on pointed out that there was so excitement during the moon landing, now that excitement is gone. Now moon is not a good place to go to. Now we'll go to Mars. The main bluff that they have actually is not just a bluff, it's a total disregard of the actual reality. The reality is that matter becomes conscious, matter becomes sentient due to the presence of the soul. Two things are existing side by side, even in this world. Inert matter, living beings. Matter by nature is inert, living entities are conscious. We all are conscious. Matter is not conscious, but our bodies, which are made of matter, is conscious. What makes this body conscious? Presence of the soul. That's the simple reality, simple fact. And the modern science totally wants to disregard that. And Srila Prabhupada wanted to call their bluff. Srila Prabhupada wanted to expose them. In 1977, Srila Prabhupada, under the auspices of Bhakti Swarup Damodar Maharaj, had one conference where Prabhupada invited Bhakti Swarup Damodar Maharaj, the director of BI at that time, Bhaktivedanta Institute, he actually arranged a conference, a science conference, inviting eminent scientists from Delhi, Agra, and from other places. And the purpose of that conference actually was to make them understand about the existence of the soul. Srila Prabhupada simply wanted to point out to this world that life never comes from matter. Life comes from life. And that is what Srila Prabhupada just wanted to make this world become aware of. Because Prabhupada saw the biggest hindrance to the propagation of Krishna consciousness is the scientists' unrealistic propaganda. They are saying all kinds of things, but that is not true. That's not real. They are denying the existence of another reality called the spiritual reality. And as a result of that, there is no opportunity, no possibility to approach the Supreme Personality of Godhead. If everything is coming from matter, then where is the room for the Supreme Personality of Godhead? On the other hand, if we recognize the fact that beyond matter, there is another reality, the spiritual reality. And the spirit souls came from that spiritual reality. And the predominating personality of the spiritual domain is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And Srila Prabhupada wanted to establish that fact in a scientific way. And in order to do that, Srila Prabhupada wanted to make the scientific presentation. And that is the idea behind the Vedic Planetarium. Prabhupada wanted the whole world to come here and see that beyond this material nature, there is a spiritual reality. And not only that, this material nature, there is a proper description of what this material nature is like. They are speculating so many things in the name of science, primordial soup, and Big Bang theory, everything. Their point is, creation came out of accident. One American philosopher made a point once. He said that the concept that creation came out of accident is as absurd as the concept that there was an explosion in a printing press and the types fell in such order that the Webster dictionary was printed. From accident we never get order. From accident we get chaos. But here we are seeing this material nature is maintaining such a beautiful order. Therefore we have to recognize that there is an intelligent being who is controlling everything. Behind this creation there is the wonderful arrangement of a personality who with inconceivable ability. And how simple this fact actually is to understand. Like once Srila Prabhupada took a plum, prune actually, dried plum. And after taking the plum, a prune, Srila Prabhupada held the seed. And I was serving him at that time. Srila Prabhupada said, inside this, there is a tree. In this tree, there are innumerable fruits. In those fruits, there are innumerable seeds. In those seeds, there are innumerable trees. In those trees, there are innumerable fruits. He said, how can anybody ever think that they can create something like that in their laboratory. They're claiming that they'll create life out of matter. They'll create life out of chemicals or whatever. Let them just produce a seed like this with the inconceivable possibility of innumerable trees endlessly. And that's why, to expose the bluffs of the modern scientists, Prabhupada actually wanted to establish the Vedic Planetarium, where the Vedic concept, the Vedic wisdom will be presented. The concept of the creation, every universe has 14 planetary systems. There are innumerable universes floating in the causal ocean. They're coming from the breathing of Mahavishnu. And in those, each universe has 14 planetary systems. Every universe has the same structure. 7 upper, 7 lower planetary systems. And the universe then has 7 coverings. And then beyond that is the Brahma Jyoti, the spiritual light. And then there is the spiritual reality. And the spiritual reality, in the spiritual sky, there are innumerable Vaikuntha planets. Then beyond that is Ayodhya, Mathura, Ayodhya, Dwarka, Mathura Mandal. And then there is Vrindavan and Mayapur. The Golok region has got two chambers, prakoshtas, two chambers. One side of Golok is Vrindavan, and the other side of the Golok is Navadvip. In Vrindavan, Krishna, the original Supreme Personality of Godhead, is enjoying with his devotees by exchanging their loving relationship with them. And the love that Krishna is enjoying in Vrindavan is distributing in Navadvip as Sri Chaitanya. So that is the purpose of this temple. Now, as I asked you all, how many of you want this temple to come? Come on. Wonderful. To build the temple, what do you need? Right. Okay. Pragosh Prabhu said cement. Only cement? Cement, steel, stone, so many things. But the bottom line is, Lakshmi. So how many of you are prepared to offer, how many of you want that Lakshmi Devi should come to bless this project? So how many of you have already contributed to this project? How many of you did not contribute to this project? And how many of you want to take this wonderful opportunity to continue in this project? Thank you very much. Now, you know Radha Jivan Prabhu? I tell you, Radha Jivan, just identify yourself, Radha Jivan Prabhu. Radha Jivan Prabhu is from Dune School. How many of you are from India? You know, anyway, the Dune School in Dehradun is one of the most prestigious schools in India. For example, Rajiv Gandhi and Sanjay Gandhi were from Dune School. Amitabh Bachchan was from Dune School. So, Radha Jivan is coming from a very, very wealthy aristocratic family. He became a devotee, sacrificing his very bright future in the material plane. He joined at the age of about 19, I think, Radha Jivan. And he joined in Mayapur also. And then Radha Jivan got married. Then he went to America. Now he runs a very successful business. Very successful business there. But he handed over the business to his sons. And you know what he's doing? He's going all over the world trying to raise funds for this temple of Vedic. Yeah. In the year 2014, Radhajivan Prabhu with Brajavilas Prabhu raised $8.5 million. Why he is doing it? Let's try to understand that. Why he is doing it? You know why he is doing it? Because he is very smart. He knows that by doing it, he is making his arrangement up there in the spiritual sky. Because this service for the sake of Srila Prabhupada is going to please Krishna so much that he is going to reserve a very special place for him in the spiritual sky. So please help him. And also take advantage. Do you also want to have the similar kind of advantage? How many of you want to go back to spiritual sky? And what's the easiest way of going back to the spiritual sky? Easiest way is by pleasing Krishna's pure devotee. And who is undoubtedly the most wonderful pure devotee of Krishna? Srila Prabhupada. So please try to take advantage of this wonderful opportunity of pleasing Srila Prabhupada by assisting him in building this temple of Vedic Planetarium. Thank you all very much. All glories to Srila Prabhupada.
His Holiness, back to you, Maharaj Ki. Thank you very much, Maharaj. Just while Maharaj was speaking, and he was talking about, actually at the very end, you will put your hand up to go back to the spiritual world, but if there's anything even higher than that, it's to, wherever you go, to be able to preach Krishna consciousness and distribute the mercy of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And in the context of science, that's a huge task. I was reading on the BBC website about a month ago, and I'm sure the article is still there on the BBC website, so you can all read it also. And we know that the BBC is the most authoritative Shastra in the material world. You know, everyone will accept that. It's more authoritative than CNN and all those funny American ones. Anyway, the article on the BBC website was, it started out by saying that religion has had a lot to say about the origin of the universe, the origin of creation like that, whereas science has had very little to say. And I thought to myself, really? It seems like it's had an awful lot to say. But anyway, then the article went on to present their case for the creation of the universe. And I've actually, I know it off by heart, and I just wrote it down while Marge was speaking. It was a long article, but when it came to the key point about the existence of the universe, it said that the universe, and this is quote verbatim, popped into existence out of nothing. Now, these were like eminent scientists that were contributing to this article, and it was a big long thing. It must have been about 10 or 12 screens long. And the essence of it was, this universe has popped into existence out of nothing. Then they went on to explain that logic, and they said, as nothing is inherently unstable, something had to manifest from it, and this is what manifested from nothing. So nothing, just to let you know, is inherently unstable. So if you have no money, you have nothing, don't worry, that's inherently unstable, you will become rich eventually.
Not only rich, a billion.
The most wealthy. But the other thing, just as an interesting kind of preaching point, which is interesting, is that in many respects, though, the way that the universe, what they say there is actually true, because material scientists the only knowledge they have is based on the material senses, what they can see, what they can touch, what they can taste, what they can feel, etc. So because the universe is coming from a different plane, the creation, it's coming from the subtle plane and ultimately the spiritual plane, from their perspective, it actually comes from nothing because they have no access to that subtle and spiritual plane. So as we're told in the Bhagavad Gita, the difference between, or the connection between phenomena and noumena. from the phenomena point of view, the material scientists and Bhagavatam aren't actually at much odds. The only thing is that the material scientists are not accepting the noumena behind the phenomena. So actually, in one sense, if we could convince them of that, the whole thing would be sorted. And finally, I'll just comment on what Maharaj said. 100%. In 1977, when Srila Prabhupada left this world, I was still in school. And one of our teachers was enthusiastically telling us, like with great passion, he was telling us, when you grow up, when you're my age, he was in his 30s, something like that, he said, when you grow up and you're my age, you will be going for your holidays, your vacation, you will be going to the moon. That was a big thing, you know? And then all of a sudden, sometime in the mid-80s or the early 90s, they just, the moon is forgotten about. They don't, and as Maharaj says, now they're going to Mars and all these different places. So bluff, bluff, bluff. Also, I wasn't going to mention Lakshmi, because you know when our children are like 6 months old or so, we give them the choice of the Bhagavatam or money, and we're always hoping that they'll choose the Bhagavatam. So I wasn't going to mention money in the Bhagavatam class. But now I can follow in Bhakti Chiru Maharaj's footsteps, because he did. And I'll just mention that Radha Jivan Prabhu and Braj Vilas Prabhu, is Braj Vilas there as well? People should see Braj Vilas as well. There's Braj Vilas Prabhu. He's him and Radha Jivan Prabhu are the main fundraisers for the TOPP. And as Maharaj said, they collected in 2014 8.5 million US dollars. That's the good news. The not so good news is that's only about 15% of what they need. So there's a lot more service to do to help them collect the rest of the Lakshmi. Okay, so now I'd like to introduce our next speaker, waiting patiently over there. And Maharaj is also a huge fundraiser in ISKCON. Actually, maybe Maharaj, Gopal Krishna Maharaj, maybe should join the TOVP fundraising team. Gopal Krishna Maharaj can become an honorary member of the TOVP fundraising team. Because Maharaj, all the wonderful things that he's done in ISKCON over the last 45 or more years, one of the things that he does, he's a fantastic fundraiser, and he's built huge temples all over India. So Gopal Krishna Maharaj, you would like to say a few words?
Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Ramanitananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shri Vajra Gaur Bhaktivinoda Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Krishna Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama,
Hare Krishna. Almost everyone connected to ISKCON.
Maharaj, you see the picture in the other? Take the picture.
Almost everyone connected to ISKCON knows the importance of Mayapur Dham. After establishing ISKCON in the Western countries, Prabhupada came to India in a strong desire that the Vedic culture, true Vedic culture, be re-established in India. And when Prabhupada returned to India, one of the first things he wanted to do was build a temple in Sri Dham Mayapur. And with great difficulty, Prabhupada managed to get some land in 1971 in Sri Dham Mayapur. And as you heard the other day, the first Mayapur festival was inaugurated in 1972, in which about 50 devotees took part. Prabhupada personally established this Mayapur Vrindavan Festival, so that our devotees were engaged in this preaching work, meeting challenges, can come to India, visit the most holy of all holy places, and get spiritually recharged. So it is by Prabhupada's mercy that this festival has gradually expanded, and more devotees are coming to India to relish the transcendental atmosphere of Sri Dham Mayapur. Sri Dham Mayapur is the most important place, the birthplace of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And our acharyas have given a lot of importance. We read about Lord Nityananda telling Jiva Goswami that very soon there will be an adbhut, outstanding temple from where the message of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu will be broadcasted. And that outstanding temple refers to what? The TOVP. So you heard from Bhakti Charu Swami and Prabhupada Prabhu the importance of the scientific presentation. Prabhupada wanted to establish that how true Vedic culture can be practiced. And he wanted a very magnificent temple in Sridhar, Mayapur. Not only did he desire a strong, magnificent temple here, he wanted this temple to prove to the world the Vedic concept as explained in the Srimad Bhagavatam and as you just heard. So therefore Prabhupada called this place the Temple of Vedic Planetarium. And Thakur Bhaktivinoda Prabhupada said he is virtually the founder of this Krishna consciousness movement. But Thakur Bhaktivinoda had started presenting the message of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to universities around the world, and he had a strong desire to develop Mayapur. He could not do much, but he gave the task to Bhakti Sinanda Saraswati Thakur, who established a Gaudiya Math and established a beautiful temple in Yogamaya. So Prabhupada knew this was Lord Nityananda's prediction that an Adbhut temple should be built here. This was Thakur Bhaktivinoda's desire. This was Bhakti Sinandaji's desire. So Prabhupada endeavored to realize this prediction of Nityananda Prabhu and the previous Acharya. Once Prabhupada was taking a massage in Calcutta, and one of our godbrothers, Giriraj Swami, met Prabhupada. So Maharaj said, "Prabhupada, how can we please you?" But that should be everyone's desire, how they can please Prabhupada. Right? Everyone agrees?
Everyone.
So Giriraj Swami's question was, "How can we please you?" And then he himself volunteered the reply. By distributing books, and by helping build the Vedic Planetarium. And then Prabhupada heard that, he said, "You have understood my mind." So Prabhupada had this strong desire. One was to distribute books, we talked about this yesterday. And the other one was to build this Vedic Planetarium. Prabhupada had a great desire to develop Mayapur as an international project, as an international where the international community would come and live, but where life would be based on the Vedic teachings, on the Vedic culture. So Prabhupada wanted this. He personally laid the foundation stone when he was on the planet, but unfortunately the project could not get started due to problems with the government in Bengal. They had a communist government in power for a long time in Bengal. And finally, years ago, we were able to start this project. Prabhupada wanted Mayapur to develop as an international center where people from the whole world would come and be eager to come. Prabhupada on the morning walk in 76 said, just like the whole world wants to come and visit Taj Mahal, he wanted people from the whole world to come and visit Mayapur Dham. Prabhupada made Mayapur Dham. He said, this is Prabhupada opened temples all over the world, but declared Mayapur as the world headquarters for ISKCON. So we have a great challenge ahead of us. And the challenge is, we want to endeavor to work together to fulfill Nityananda's prediction to Jiva Goswami, Thakur Bhaktivinoda's desire, Bhakti Siddhantaji's desire, and Srila Prabhupada's desire. And that is develop Mayapur, especially build this temple of Vedic Planetarium. So a lot of work has been done. We have a very dedicated team, consisting headed by Bhavananda Prabhu, Sadhpuj and others. And the team consists of devotees who have professional skills who are sacrificing their professional careers just because they want to help realize this project. As all of you know, Amrish Prabhu, a dear disciple of Prabhupada, played a big role, and he contributed over $30 million already for this project. But this is not a small amount. But Amrish Prabhu also has his limitations. He's not the World Bank. If he was a World Bank, then he could go on writing checks indefinitely. So he's done his share. Now, what is our position? Do we have any responsibility or no? So every member of this movement should work to realize this. This is a nice quote from Srila Prabhupada. Now we all together make this Vedic Planetarium very nice, so that people will come and see. From the description in the Srimad Bhagavatam, you prepare this Vedic Planetarium. My idea is to attract people of the whole world to Maya. So Prabhupada has said on numerous occasions that our service to Krishna never goes in vain. Does it ever go in vain? In the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, you read the story of a lady selling fruits. She was saying, "Brijbasis, does anyone want to buy some fruits?" And the Lord, young baby, came with some grains in his small hands to barter for the fruits. These days you have the currency system, but at one time you had the barter system. But by the time the Lord reached the lady, the grains had all fallen from his small hands. Anyway, the lady was very attracted to the Lord's beauty, and the lady gave the fruits without any grains in exchange. And what did she get back and look at? When she looked at her basket, what did she find?
Gold and diamonds.
Huh?
Gold and diamonds.
Fruits made of jewelry. Golden apples. So what does this prove? The service to Krishna never goes in vain, am I right? In the Chaitanya Mangala, you read another story. The Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was racing towards the Jagannath Puri temple, saying, "Jagannath, Jaga, 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 Jaga." And he left his associate behind. He was ahead. On the way, he felt thirsty. So there was a young boy selling buttermilk. The Lord took the pot containing the buttermilk and drank the whole pot, one minute. And after drinking the pot, the boy said, "Paisa, money, money, money." The Lord said, "I don't have any money, but my colleagues are coming behind me. They will give me the money." So he gave credit for a few minutes, and the Lord raced ahead to Jagannath Temple. When the colleagues arrived, the boy said, "Your sannyasi friend drank all my buttermilk and said he'll pay for it. So please give me money, I want to go home." The colleague said, "But we don't have any money either." So the young boy said, "Okay, tell that sannyasi, this was my donation to him." And he said, "Okay, now it's time for me to go home." So he tried to lift the pot to go home. And the pot, according to his logic, should have been empty, because the Lord drank the entire buttermilk that was in the pot. But when he tried to lift the pot, he couldn't do it. It was so heavy. He was shocked. He opened the lid, and he saw inside the lid, the whole pot was full of diamonds and jewelry. He gave a little buttermilk, and what happened? The whole pot was full of diamonds and jewelry. He ran behind Lord Chaitanya, and the boy was blessed with the love of God. He started dancing and singing. So What does this show? That when you serve Krishna, it never goes in vain. Now some of you may be calculating, okay, then if I give it a TOVP, my purse could be full of diamonds. And it may not happen materially, but it's happening spiritually. Prabhupada said, if you help build the temple of Lord Krishna, Krishna will build a residence for you in the spiritual plane. So, we want to encourage all of you to please try and help complete this project. We had a similar program last year, and actually this year, I suggested Prabhupada, maybe we should do the program in the temple. But due to security reasons, the managers did not want to take the risk of either of you slipping on a construction site or any brick falling on your head. They said, not this year, maybe next year. So as you can see, there is a lot of progress. But we still have to do a lot more. When we first started the project, we were hoping to complete the project by 2016. What is significant about 2016?
50th year.
What's significant about 2015? Prabhupada's departure. Prabhupada left India from Calcutta. And when Prabhupada was leaving India, there was no one there to tell him bye-bye. You know, even when you make a small trip, somebody's here to see you off. When Prabhupada left by Jaladutta, there was no one there at the port. So, 50 years ago, August, Prabhupada sailed from India. And next year, 2016 is the year that Prabhupada incorporated ISKCON in New York. So, we were at one time hoping to complete the project by 2016. But it appears that that won't happen now. So, we are trying to complete this project as fast as possible. The only slowdown is due to limited, what's that called? Limited luxury. So there are several schemes in which all of you can take part. Bhaktacharya Swami introduced Radha Jeevan to you. Radha Jeevan is very innovative. If any of you think you're innovative, you should compare your innovations to him. He comes up with some scheme or the other. And he has come up with several schemes. We'll let him speak afterward, if there's time, in which all of you can participate. So we want all of you to get actively involved in the Sridhar Mayapur project. Mayapur is to ISKCON what Mecca is to the Muslims and Vatican is to the Christians. And Prabhupada wanted Mayapur to become an internationally well-known city. Prabhupada, as I said, Mayapur should be like the Taj Mahal. You go to any corner of the world, people know the Taj Mahal, isn't it? Taj Mahal at least needs no introduction. So similarly, all of you should become Mayapur's traveling ambassadors and promote this TOVP. And as I said, we help build this TOVP, Krishna will help you. When Prabhupada was in Bombay, as some of you may know, Prabhupada had to struggle to get the Hare Krishna plan. So there was a life member devotee called Mr. Sethi, who helped Prabhupada a lot by fighting with the tenants and local people. Anyway, helping build the temple. So Prabhupada told him, you're building Krishna's temple here, and Krishna is building a residence in the spiritual world. So we want to earnestly appeal to all of you to please actively help develop this project. Of course, the present target is 7 years. But we can do it faster if all of you get actively involved. And if you get involved, if you have the strong desire to serve Mayapur, Krishna will help you and bless you, and you'll be able to make spiritual advancement. So thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
His Holiness Gopal Krishna Maharaj Ki. We will now allow Bhakti to leave. as he has to attend a meeting that I have to attend too, actually. But we'll allow Bhaktachuru Maharaj to leave now. Thank you very much, Bhaktachuru Maharaj. I just want to read, before handing to the next speaker, just read one quote. You know, at the time of initiation, we're asked to chant 16 rounds and follow the four rules. And of course, that comes from Srila Prabhupada. Well, I have a revelation today. And the revelation I have today is that Srila Prabhupada broke one of those principles. Okay? And here's the proof. This is Prabhupada speaking in Mayapur, 27th of September, 1974. So it was the desire of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur that Europeans and Americans would come here and chant Hare Krishna mantra. That prophecy is now being fulfilled, and that is my satisfaction. I tried my little bit to fulfill the desire of Bhaktivinoda Thakur. At my old age of 70 years, it was gambling also. I simply thought that this was the desire. Of course, my Guru Maharaj, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Goswami Prabhupada, he also asked me to do this. Anyway, at least there is a place now when, where there are Europeans and Americans may come and live peacefully, chant Hare Krishna mantra and advance in spiritual understanding. So I'm extracting from that, my interpretation of that quote is that we can even gamble a little to make sure that the TOVP is completed. And as I said earlier, the verse from Lord Chaitanya, the Akakya Maranaya Payabolo Harinama Sankirtan verse, is that Lord Chaitanya needed help to spread the Sankirtan movement, and the TOVP also need help. With that in mind, this year the GBC body officially announced 2015 as the year of the TOVP. This is the year of the TOVP. Now, yes, okay, no problem. Now, Maharaj also mentioned when he was speaking that Mayapur is to devotees what Mecca is to the Muslims and what the Vatican is to the Christians. And I don't know if you've noticed, coming from a Christian background, I don't know if you've noticed that we hear this lovely bell ringing every now and again. Have you heard that bell? That really nice deep boom. Every time I hear it, I think I have to go to church. But the goal is to have that bell ringing constantly. Having that bell ringing constantly, because I think that bell indicates something in the region of 1.6 lakhs has been donated to the TOVP. So that's in the new Seva office, just on the corner there of the long building coming to the Lotus building. But if you're not quite that wealthy, but you all look very wealthy to me, you've got a booth just behind us here, and there you can give a few hundred rupees. But when you get to 1.6 lakhs, you'll be directed to this building down there. So anyway, it's the year of the TOVP, and before we ask our final speaker, the one and only Jayapataka Swami Maharaj to speak. Yes, go ahead, that's okay. Don't be shy clapping, by the way. You know, don't be shy clapping. We won't stop you doing that. Personally, I still think that's a shy clap. Just clapping doesn't mean that you're not shy. It's how you clap. I still think there are a few inhibitions in there. Some of you are still a little bit shy, but you can practice in a moment, but just wait a second. You can practice when I introduce now. Just before, as I said, our last speaker, we're going to give a couple of minutes to the person that you've heard about already and the main man behind the fundraising for the TOVP since, the main man since, very important that Gopal Krishna Maharaj mentioned Ambarish Prabhu. That's very, very, very important. What you see behind you is 90-95% of that is as a result of Ambarish Prabhu. So it's very, very important that we recognize that. But now, the man who's taken over the mantle of Ambarish Prabhu, a couple of minutes to speak, Radha Jivan Prabhu, Radha Jivan Prabhu, yay!
Hare Krishna, thank you very much. So many glories have been said about my past and educational background, etc. But I want to mention that since I have taken over the service of TOVP, all along the way, the senior devotees, Gopal Krishna Maharaj, Bhakti Churu Maharaj, Pragosh Prabhu, and specially His Holiness Jayapataka Swami Maharaj, every step of the way, he has given tremendous, tremendous encouragement to both me and Braj Vilas. There have been many times when we have fallen from our nishtha to be able to go on in this work of asking for money, traveling, and looking for where devotees can participate, and they have always supported. I was on the plane with Jayapataka Maharaj in Russia. I was sitting next to him. He put his hand on my hand and he said, Radha Jivan, you are constantly thinking, sleeping, eating, only TOVP. You put me to shame. So to him I replied, I said, Maharaj, you hardly even have a body left. And look at the way you are traveling, and always you have your uttariya out, begging for money for TOVP. So who is the greater devotee? Our ISKCON society has grown so large, the wheel of ISKCON has grown so big, and it is moving at such a fast pace. But this Mayapur Dham, Srila Prabhupada has told us, indicated to us, is the hub of that wheel. We must take care of this hub. We have dressed our society, the ISKCON society, in the last 50 years so beautifully, with so many thousands and thousands of devotees, with so much book distributed, beautiful deity seva, beautiful aradhana and sadhana, wonderful moral livings. But this TOVP is the crown that all of us together will have to put on the body of ISKCON. Let us crown our wonderful body of ISKCON with this TOVP. Srila Prabhupada was very sentimentally attached to Sridhar Mayapur. He mentioned, Bombay is my office, Vrindavan is my home, but Mayapur is my place of worship. One time he was giving a lecture to a few American disciples, and he mentioned that every Vaishnava Acharya, every Gaudiya Vaishnava Acharya has done something wonderful in Sridhar Mayapur as his personal offering to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He cited the example, Bhakti Vinod Thakur Maharaj, even though he was a district magistrate, he went door to door to 50,000 householders, collected 1 rupee and built the Yogapeet, the birthplace of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and that was his personal offering to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He said, my Guru Maharaj, in a short period of 15 years, was able to build 67 new temples all over India, but he built the biggest mutt, the biggest temple in Sridhar Mayapur, when nobody was coming to Mayapur, because that was his personal Shraddhanjali, his personal offering at the lotus feet of Sriman Mahaprabhu. And then Srila Prabhupada folded his hands and he looked at his disciples and he said, I thank you very much, you boys and girls, for helping me to also offer this temple as my personal Shraddhanjali, as my personal gift to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And then Srila Prabhupada had so many tears in his eyes, he was not able to speak anymore. This was Srila Prabhupada's emotion and sentiment towards the TOVP temple. Now that we are coming into the 50th anniversary, we should all feel deep gratitude towards Srila Prabhupada and our acharyas for giving us this wonderful ISKCON society. And as that gratitude, we should offer something very deep to Srila Prabhupada. And for this reason, in 2012, when we started our campaign, we started with the square foot program, that by donating one square foot, you will be able to contribute to the temple. But we needed 300,000 devotees to come forward with one square foot donation, and practically that was not possible. It was taking too much time. So then we upgraded to another idea, that let devotees donate one golden brick, and that brick would go in the platform where the deities would stand. And that golden brick would be 50,000, 1 lakh, and 1.5 lakhs of rupees, or $1,600, $2,100. And that would sufficiently bring more money. That was very successful in 13 and 14. Over 5,000 devotees have participated in donating the golden brick towards the TOVP project. In the month of Kartik last year, we thought, let us upgrade more to facilitate those devotees who can give more, because in the aspect of collecting money, there is an axiom. It says 20% of the devotees, 20% of the people contribute to 80% of the project, and 80% of the people contribute 20% of the project. So now we are looking for those 20% people. So we have minted 1,008 silver coins with TOVP on one side and Srila Prabhupada on the other side. It says ISKCON 50. These 1,000 devotees who come forward and make a pledge to $11,000 or 6.5 lakhs of rupees will be collectively be able to offer to the project $11 million. And this is the kind of money we require in order to bring this project into the second phase. I want to tell you a small story from the Mahabharata. In the Mahabharata, at the end of Yudhishthira Maharaja's yagya, when he had done his Ashwamedha yagya, everyone was satisfied. All the big people who had come were fed and satisfied and given gifts and were sent back. Right in the end, the five Pandavas, after the yagya, sat down to take prasadam. After taking prasad, as Yudhishthira Maharaj and the Pandavas were washing their hands, there was a mongoose. The mongoose came and stood right underneath Yudhishthira Maharaj in order to catch some of the water from the hand washing of Yudhishthira Maharaj. So the people around, they were trying to shoo him away, and he spoke in human language. He said, please do not shoo me away. Please look at me. Half my body is golden and the other half is normal. And I want to tell you why. He said, a couple of years ago, there was a famine in one village far away from here. And in that famine, there was a Brahmana family. They were five brothers. After many days of fasting, they were not getting any food. Finally, they received some food. As they were about to eat, some beggars came and they said, we will die if you do not give us your food. So the five brothers offered that food to the other people. Again, a few days passed and the same thing happened. They received food, they were about to eat, and some more people came and took the food away. Third time again, it happened, the Brahmana brothers were about to die because they themselves had fasted for so long. But when the food came, some more people arrived and said, we will die if you do not give us your food. They very calmly donated their food to those people, and then they were washing their hands even though they had not eaten. I happened to be there, the mongoose said, and some of the water sprinkled on my body, but it only sprinkled on half my body. Because of the purity of their sacrifice, because of the intensity of their sacrifice, half my body became golden from the sprinkle of their water. Since then, I have been looking for a yagya that will be of the same intensity as theirs, so I can make my body fully golden. And when I heard Yudhishthira Maharaj is having this yagya, I thought, who could be performing a bigger yajna than Yudhishthira Maharaj. And therefore, I have come here to catch the water from the sprinkle of Yudhishthira Maharaj's hand in order to make my entire body golden. But alas, I have seen the water has fallen on my body, but it has not made my body golden. And therefore, I conclude that those Brahmana brothers who sacrificed intensely, their yajna was bigger and higher than the yajna of Yudhishthira Maharaj. So I'd say this story to all of you devotees, that unless and until we build this temple with utmost sacrifice, this temple will not be the highest yajna in Kali Yuga. This temple will not stand to purify the world. Like Nityananda Prabhu said, Iha ek adbhut mandira hoibe vikash. Gorango nitya seva hoibe prakash. If Gauranga Mahaprabhu's nitya seva has to be prakashaman, if this temple is to influence each and every living entity for the next 10,000 years, then we devotees who are assembled here, we have to make the utmost sacrifice. And before I conclude, I want to tell you, there are many instances in our society where devotees are making tremendous sacrifice. Yesterday, a 16-year-old girl came to our office and she said, I have received 20,000 rupees as scholarship for coming first in class. I want to donate it to TOBP. Another lady came to us from Russia and she said, my friend has sent all this jewelry worth $7,000 so that you can sell it and give it to the TOBP. A small little boy from Pune, his father came with a piggy bank and he said there is a few thousand rupees in it that he has collected throughout the year by going around begging for the TOBP. So like this, there are many, many devotees, unknown to all of us, who are sacrificing, and therefore they are making this temple a very, very spiritual temple. I plead to all of you, please, this is an opportunity in our lifetimes that such a monumental temple is coming up. Take this project very seriously. Not only donate with utmost sacrifice to build this temple, but also become beggars for this temple. Go ask your friends, ask your relatives, ask everyone you meet that please make some contribution to this wonderful Adbhut Mandir that is coming up. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
His Grace Radhajivan Prabhu Ki. Well, I think I need to inform Radhajivan Prabhu that you have all sacrificed your breakfast this morning. So thank you all very much for that. So now I want to introduce our last speaker. And I think there's no better way. I think for most of us in the Hare Krishna movement, at least it was the case for me, that the first verse that we learned when we met the devotees was Dehino Smimyatha Dehe. And I want you to focus on that verse when I read this quote here. He spoke these words in Mayapur in 1976. And he said, and this is as an introduction to Jayapataka Maharaj. So train these small boys. I am very glad, especially to see the small children from all other countries, Indian, Bengalis, all together, forgetting their bodily consciousness. That is the greatest achievement in this movement, that everyone forgets the bodily conception of life. Nobody thinks themselves here as European, American, Indian, Hindu, Muslim, Christian. They forget all these designations and simply they are ecstatic in chanting the Hare Krishna mantra. So kindly, what you have begun, do not break it. Continue it very jubilantly. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the master of Mayapur, he will be very much pleased upon you. And ultimately, you will go back home, back to Godhead. Thank you very much. I think those words, we talk about building the temple, we talk about, you know, presenting it as the alternative view of the creation of the universe, etc. And all of those things we talk about. But really, as Prabhupada said here, the biggest thing of all, for all of us, is to try to transcend the bodily concept of life. So Jayapataka Maharaj, along with Bhavananda Prabhu, who's very much involved in the TOVP, they were really the first leaders to come here to Mayapur. And it's built from what it was then. I think at the beginning, I said the other day, there were just 8 devotees here. And now there are devotees from every community all over the world. And we come together, chant Hare Krishna, and we transcend the bodily conception of life. And I think a big, big thank you to that goes to His Holiness Jayapataka Maharaj. So now, big warm welcome for our last speaker today, His Holiness Jayapataka Maharaj.
Since my voice is very down, what I say will be repeated by Achintya Chaitanya Das.
If you still can't understand, talk to your translator.
If you still can't understand, talk to your translator.
So we heard a lot of nice messages.
So we heard a lot of nice messages from Bhakti Charu Swami, His Holiness Gopal Krishna Goswami,
His Grace Pragosh Das,
His Grace Pragosh Das,
our present chairman of the GBC,
our present chairman of the GBC,
and His Grace Radha Jivan Das.
And His Grace Radha Jivan Das.
Ah. remembering how Radhaji was swimming with us across the Ganges.
I was remembering how Radha Jeevan was once swimming with us across the Ganges.
And suddenly he got a cramp or something and started to drown. And somehow I could hold him up and take him to the side. But now, you see that he's holding up
The TOVP fundraising.
So I got the blessings of the Ganges.
He got the blessings of the Ganges. I remember how Srila Prabhupada had said those words which Radha Jeevan mentioned.
How he had given details about each acharya in our line. Had done something for developing Mayapur. So,
and when he came to himself, he said, I also desire to do something in my own humble way.
And I'm very grateful to all of you.
Whoever is helping me. Then he choked up and he started crying.
So, this is our chance for all of us.
To help Srila Prabhupada.
To do something. To make Lord Chaitanya well known around the world. Even in India. People know Lord Chaitanya, oh, he's a saint or he's a sannyasi. How many know him as a special avatar?
Very few. I was sitting and giving a class in Mumbai. At the Juhu Temple.
People were crowded around Radharajihari and
Shri Radha Rasa Vihari and Shri Sitaram Lakshman Hanuman. But Nithai God Temple, near the altar, it was empty. The deities were there, but no people. I told all the people
that the secret is
you get the mercy of Nithai Gaur. Then you get the mercy of Shri Radha Rasavihari. So people went over to Nithai Gaur and prayed for their mercy. Here in India,
very few people understand that Lord Chaitanya is Krishna himself. And someone asked me, why there's so few people that know? I said, that's our fault. We're not publishing, we're not
I said, we are not publishing, we are not spreading the message around sufficiently.
Oh, you heard how? I mean, just say one book.
We heard how if we distribute one book,
people can read it and spend hours and hours and hours.
People can read it and spend hours and hours and hours.
So that's a more effective way of reaching.
That's more effective way of preaching.
By this temple.
But this temple
was built by distributing millions of books.
Has been built by distributing millions of books.
And also by the great contribution of Ambarish Prabhu.
Also by the great contribution of Ambarish Prabhu.
So, like a book has more effect.
Like how a book has more effect.
This temple
of the Vedic Planetarium
will have much more effect. And people all over the world will recognize Lord Chaitanya.
And people from all over the world will recognize Lord Chaitanya. Prabhupada was very liberal-minded.
He said, Muslims, they can stay here.
He said, the Muslims, they can stay here.
If they chant the rounds and attend the aartis.
If they chant the rounds and attend the aartis.
We don't mind if they do their namaz five times.
We don't mind if they do their namaz five times. But they should chant 16 rounds.
Prabhupada ki. So, but we only have the grass hut.
But we had only the grass hut.
So God then was saying that here we will build a big temple.
And Srila Prabhupada is saying that here we will build a big temple.
One of the biggest in the world.
One of the biggest in the world.
So he had this vision in his mind.
So he had this vision in his mind.
Now we can play our part to see that manifest.
So now we can play our part to see it manifest. And Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur,
he told Prabhupada that by your spreading
Krishna consciousness
around the world, this is very good for you. And all those who help you.
And all those who help you.
Who wants to help Srila
Prabhupada?
Who doesn't want to help Prabhupada?
Who doesn't want to help Srila Prabhupada?
No one.
So, this is our special chance.
To do something for the TOVP.
I was reading how a devotee came and he surrendered at the feet of Krishna. And Krishna, he likes to reciprocate with his devotee. So he was thinking, this devotee has given his life to me.
This devotee has given his life to me.
What can I give him?
What can I give him?
So then, he does all this on that, his stupa money is on. Another reward given. He gave us all jewels.
And so Krishna took out his Kaustubha money, never before given out all these jewels.
And he embraced that devotee. With tears in his eyes. Krishna is so wonderful. But if we have a hard heart. We may not immediately sense how wonderful Krishna is. But that's why Krishna as Lord Chaitanya. He makes loving Krishna very, he gives
loving Krishna freely.
And the devotees, by chanting Hare Krishna,
by dancing, by reading books, by preaching,
they get the special mercy of Lord Chaitanya. So our opportunity now,
is to do something
to help the TOVP.
Let people know
how wonderful is Lord Chaitanya. He would deliver conditioned souls of all types. He delivered a farmer.
He delivered an offensive criminal. He delivered an offensive Brahmana. Tantri. He delivered a drunkard.
He delivered
Brahmins.
He went one place.
He saw an astrologer. He said, "Oh, astrologer, read my hand. What was I in my previous birth?" And the astrologer took his hand. My God, what is this?
Bore.
B-O-A-R, bore.
Green man.
With a bow and arrow.
Black man.
Dark blue.
With a peacock feather.
And a flute.
Tell me.
The Lord Chaitanya said, What do you see? Tell me. I'm not feeling so alright.
Come tomorrow.
He went back to his room.
So, although Lord Chaitanya he didn't reveal
who he was,
except on a couple of rare occasions. Actually, he is Krishna. And Radharani combined.
And he gives out the mercy so freely. This place is not different from Vrindavan.
Like from here, there's a doorway to the spiritual world. And people come here to live in the spiritual world.
People come here to live in the spiritual world. And they come to die.
Go back to the spiritual world.
And go back to the spiritual world.
Oh, this temple.
So this temple
will help people.
Will help people.
To get back to the spiritual world.
To get back to the spiritual world.
And help people.
And help people.
To develop their bhakti.
To develop their bhakti.
Their devotion to Krishna.
Their devotion to Krishna. So my humble message and request is,
let's do this temple for the pleasure of Prabhupada.
Let's do this temple for the pleasure of Srila Prabhupada.
And that will be pleasing to all the previous acharyas.
And that will be pleasing to all the previous acharyas.
And that will bless the whole world.
And that will bless the whole world.
Hare Krishna.
Hare
Krishna.
Yes.
Very good.
Very good.
Preach to people.
Preach to people.
Get them to be devotees.
Get them to be devotees.
Get them to help the building of the TOVP.
Get them to help the building of the TOVP.
And have them come to Mayapur.
And have them come to Mayapur. Associate with all you wonderful devotees.
Stay put on him.
Yes.
Our Russian word, pure devotees. Just stay put on him.
Just stay put on him. Just stay put on him. By misguided by some Russian.
They call me just a pradhanam.
Just a pradhanam.
Pure devotee.
Pure devotee.
Just a pradhanam.